a good example would be extremely hot weather conditions where that can cause the cars to overheat and accelerate tire deterioration, which may also soften asphalt. And this softening of asphalt can cause to a deformation of the asphalt, terminal extension of bridge joints, and other potential hazards. Another example would be the rising sea levels, especially for transportation in coastal areas, which are more vulnerable to sea level rise. And these may lead to floods that can cause skidding and even drowning of the vehicles, and also infrastructure erosion. So our current infrastructure is designed for the current weather conditions. However, if we think that these weather conditions will change based on the climate change, we need to be ready for the future. Numerous studies have investigated the effect of adverse weather conditions on road accidents. And in order to classify these effects, the U.S. Department of Transportation released a report about its road weather management program, in which different weather variables are classified into different groups, including air temperature, humidity, wind, precipitation, fog, pavement temperature, water level, and so on. We can see these basically in three different impact categories, the first of which is roadway impacts, which includes parameters such as visibility, distance, infrastructure damage, pavement friction, and lane obstruction. The second category is traffic flow impacts, which can include traffic speed, travel time delay, speed variance, and roadway capacity. And the third being operational impacts, which can include vehicle performance, driver behavior, speed limit control, and traffic signal timing. Among all these possible weather events, precipitation has been proven to pose the greatest threat to roadway safety so far. Statistical data shows that 74% of all crashes happen on wet pavement, while 46% of crashes occur during rainfall. Effective management and proper policy making for complex systems, such as the road safety problem and the transportation problem in general, requires a holistic understanding of the system as a whole so that one can correctly interpret the interactions involved among different parameters in the system. So in order to achieve such an understanding and interpretation, it is necessary to integrate different branches of science to cover all or most of the parameters in the system, in such a way that one can analyze each parameter individually or as part of the system, given its interaction with other parameters. When we combine these parameters, of course, it depends on the level of detail that we are interested in. If you think of a map, we can look at the map from a very close proximity or look at it from an eagle view. In our case, we are interested at this moment to look from an eagle view and to see how different parameters in these different systems are related to each other. This way of looking at systems is called integrated assessment modeling. It's a very useful tool for modeling complex systems like those pertaining to environmental concerns, as well as the ones that are related to climate change and predicting its associated future weather patterns. Because such systems usually contain many subcomponents that each play their own major or minor roles within the system. Therefore, analyzing the actions and interactions among these components will be crucial to determining the behavior of the overall system. And this is also why analyzing such a system by focusing solely on single components might take us to misleading results. The main focus of integrated assessment modeling is on analyzing the feedback processes through which the actions and interactions within the system takes place. Integrated assessment modeling can integrate different branches of science for this purpose and investigate the behavior of each component within the system as well as each parameter's individual behavior. The most used approach to integrated assessment modeling utilizes system dynamic simulation modeling. The word systems here refers to the parameters interacting with each other, and the dynamics means how these interactions of these parameters behave in time. As I mentioned earlier, one of the difficulties of investigating complex systems like road safety is that the interactions between different parameters playing any role within the system are very often neglected. This oversight becomes even more serious when the system and its parameters are dynamic in nature and when parameters are time dependent. Therefore, a comprehensive system dynamic model to help policymakers find ways to reduce road fatalities and injuries should be capable of identifying all of the parameters related to road safety and should also take into account the relationships and interactions between all of these parameters. Hence, this is our goal of this project, which is using system dynamics models to picture different parameters involving in an accident and their interactions and feedbacks, and try to find the holistic relationships between all these different parameters. We see that in many previous studies, these systems were investigated individually, regardless of their interactions. In our current study, we aim to integrate all of the findings of these studies and come up with a holistic model. To do that, as I mentioned, we use system dynamics modeling. System dynamics simulation approach is a method to enhance learning in complex systems. When I say complex systems, it's a system in which large networks of components interact with each other. System dynamic modeling has been used in transportation research for many years. It actually has been used, it was found by Professor Forrester in MIT many years ago, and was used in to model urban development as well as growth, population growth in the world, and was actually an influential model that allowed the United Nations to come up with all the measures related to sustainable development. And since then, system dynamics has been used in many, many areas, including transportation. Right now, it is being used in national climate change models. When the delegates go to United Nations, some of these models are system dynamics models. The advantages of system dynamic modeling is that it provides a holistic understanding of the whole system. It's a differential equation-based model where the parameters are connected with each other, and we look at the results of these parameters by doing certain changes in the model. As I mentioned, system dynamic modeling has been used a lot in the transportation research as well for strategic policy analysis and decision-making supporting tool. It has contributed to the understanding of the relationships between the elements and the environment which they are interacting in. In a current study 2 years ago, it was found that there are more than 50 peer-reviewed journal papers that applied system dynamic modeling in transportation research problems. These problems include but are not limited to alternative fuel vehicles. Another area where I work in, and we have several papers that utilizes a system dynamic approach. Supply chain management with transportation, highway infrastructure construction and maintenance, strategic policy at urban, regional, and national scale, air transportation, and other emerging areas such as safety, city bus systems, and port security. So let us look at the model development. In the beginning, we start with looking at what are the main parameters that are typically involved in road safety and transportation and identify them. We did this through a rigorous literature review, trying to identify what are the critical parameters that we want to use for the current study. These parameters are then used in the causal loop diagram that will be introduced shortly. And here you see the major parameters that I use. These are, of course, not all of them, but the major ones. The vehicle condition based on the safety-related factors, climate change, and we will look at this based on extreme weather conditions, infrastructure condition, road safety level and infrastructure equipment, economy, looking at the wealth and resources, population, driver contribution, the accidents in which the driver's fault is the primary factor, vehicles mile traveled, accidents, the total number of accidents of the parameters. After we find the parameters, we develop a causal loop diagram. One of the main advantages, as I mentioned previously, of system dynamic modeling is that it allows for a more in-depth investigation of the relationships and interactions between different parameters within the system through their associated feedback loops, which will be used to develop the causal loop diagram. Feedback loops are the most important characteristic of any system dynamics model, as these connectors will determine how the results or the output of a sector within the system should be used as an input for another sector in the system. These feedback loops can come with a positive or negative sign, depending on their overall effect. A positive sign means it's a reinforcing loop, meaning that the related parameters have the same overall increasing or decreasing trend, such as increasing or decreasing one parameter will result in a corresponding increase or corresponding decrease in the same parameter after a full rotation within the loop. Conversely, a negative or a balancing loop means that an increase or decrease in any parameter will have the opposite effect on the same parameter after the full rotation. Here I put a simple causal loop diagram. As you see here, the relationship between the birth rate and the population and the death rate. As the birth rate increases, the population increases. As the population increases, the birth rate increases. So here we see a reinforcing loop, a loop that continuously will increase in time. On the other hand, when the population increases, the death rate will increase. When the death rate increases, the population decreases. So as you see here, the population increases the death rate, but the death rate decreases the population. This is a balancing loop, which means in time, this loop will find a balance. So here there are two loops, and these two loops will be ran together in time. So as the number of loops increases, as you will see shortly, it is impossible to calculate the impacts of all of these loops without utilizing an approach like system dynamics. Here you'll see the causal loop diagram. Unfortunately, because of the this system we are using, the quality has been compromised a little bit, but I will try to explain it as much as I can. This is the main causal loop diagram that we developed for this study that has actually many different loops. The first loop is the climate change, which is at the top. Climate change, infrastructure condition, accidents, economy, VNT, climate change. So here you see one big loop. And this loop helps us to look at the following relationship. Increasing the extreme weather events will cause the infrastructure condition to deteriorate. This deterioration will increase accident rates. The increased number of accident rates and the fatalities and injuries related to that will have a negative impact on the economy. and it will decrease the VMT, the economy, and as a result of that decrease in the VMT, the impact on climate change will decrease, because with the decreased VMT, we will have less GHG emissions, which means it will lead to less atmospheric temperature change, contributing less to extreme weather events. Now, each of these loops and each of these relationships, we look at the literature to find supporting evidence for them. So if you look at our report, project report, and our papers, you will see for each of these relationships, there is a source that we are basing these relationships off of. The next loop is climate change, driver contribution, accident rate, economy, VMT, climate change. Again, there is another loop here. Increasing frequency of extreme weather conditions, whether it's rainfall, fog, or snow, will increase the driver's contribution to traffic accidents due to the negative impacts on factors like visibility and decision making. This will increase the accident rates, which, as I mentioned earlier, will impact the economy and the VMT. The decrease in the VMT will impact the climate change. So hence here we have another causal loop diagram. The next causal loop diagram is the population, VMT, climate change, infrastructure condition, accident rate, economy, population. So this is the next one. Increasing the population will increase travel demand, which will result in increasing VMT and subsequent increases in GHG emissions, in turn increasing the atmospheric temperature. This atmospheric temperature change will then change the relevant precipitation models and increase the frequency and severity of extreme weather conditions, resulting in long-term infrastructure degradation. Subsequently, this infrastructure deterioration will increase the accident rate and thereby incur the economic losses associated with traffic accidents. Finally, although the relationship between economic prosperity and fertility rates is still debatable, it is generally accepted, and we base this on the literature, that the economic prosperity will increase the fertility to some extent. So that's another loop that we have. The next loop is infrastructure condition, accident rate, economy, VMT, and infrastructure condition. Improving the condition of the available infrastructure will result in fewer accidents and will thereby decrease the total economic burden of accidents. This increase in the economic prosperity will result in an increase in travel demand, which will increase the VMT, and this increase in the VMT will lead to greater infrastructure deterioration. As you see, we are here concerned with all these major parameters that are normally studied in different disciplines, and here we're trying to look at them from a holistic perspective. The next loop is accident rate, economy, vehicle safety, accident rate. So you see here accidents, economy, vehicle safety or vehicle conditions, and accident. Increasing the accident rates or crash rates, thank you, I just saw the chat here. Increasing the crash rates will have a negative impact on economy, which according to the literature will impact the gross domestic product up to 2%. This reduction will leave less money for vehicle safety improvements, which will result in reductions in vehicle safety, and this will increase the number or severity of future accidents. Next loop is economy, infrastructure condition, accident rate, economy. So this is the loop we're looking at the moment. A better economic situation will allow for better infrastructure conditioning, due to the increased transportation sector share from the GDP. This can also help to increase highway mileage and capacity, reducing traffic congestion while also increasing infrastructure quality. These improvements in infrastructure will also reduce accident rates, making the economy less likely to suffer from the typical economic consequences associated with traffic accidents. Next loop is population, VMT, climate change, infrastructure condition, accidents, and population again. As the population increases, the travel demand and the VMT will increase as well. This increase in the VMT will increase the GHG emissions, which will consequently increase the atmospheric temperatures, resulting in an increase in extreme weather events, which will negatively impact the infrastructure condition. This combination of extreme weather conditions and poor infrastructure condition will increase the accident rate and associated injuries and crashes, directly decreasing the population. So here, as you see, we have looked at all causal loop diagrams in our model. This is the qualitative aspect of our system dynamics modeling approach. After we look at the qualitative aspect and make sure that all the relationships that we have are supported by our research or by the research that has already been done in the literature, we start looking at the model formulation. The developed causal loop diagrams will help construct the stock and flow diagram, which is the quantitative aspect of the SD modeling process. Each of the submodels that I will discuss contains mathematical formulations of the relationships between different parameters, and each submodel focuses on a specific area to road safety, including submodels that represent motor vehicle safety, highway systems, and the environment, as well as two submodels that mainly focus on economic losses due to transportation-related issues. So let's look at these models. The first submodel is the economic losses submodel. And just to show you here, this is a quantitative model. We have the parameters that are impacting the flow. What you see here is the flow. And then what you see here is what we call the stuck. Hence, we call this the stuck flow diagram. What affects the flow is everything that you see here. When I say flow, what I mean, you can think of this as a bathtub dynamics. In the bathtub, the stuck is the bath, is the tub. What is in the tub? And the flow is the flow that we have. So by increasing or decreasing the flow of water, we decrease the stuck that is in the bathtub. What we do here is not different from it from a theoretical perspective. It's just that we are not applying this knowledge to the bathtub, but we are applying it to the transportation or the road safety problem. And so all of these factors that you see on the left-hand side are the factors that are directly affecting the flow, and the only thing that affects the stuck is the flow. So the first submodel is economic losses submodel with respect to fatalities, injuries, and property damage only. This submodel uses the output, the total fatalities of the with injury and property damages, and estimate the total economic cost for all types of crashes. We use data from NHTSA to calculate many numbers that are here based in this model. The next submodel is the motor vehicle safety standard submodel. It is used to model the role of vehicle safety standards in preventing roadway fatalities. The Federal Motor Vehicle Safety Standards aims to provide minimum safety performance requirements according to NHTSA These requirements are specified such that the public is protected against unreasonable risks of crashes occurring as a result of the design, construction, or performance of motor vehicles. Here, what you see is the estimated number of lives saved through implementations of many of the standards that are published by the NHTSA, and we connect them in the submodel. The next submodel is the highway system capacity submodel, which presents a more holistic view of the problem by concentrating on parameters like population, number of vehicles, VMT, vehicle fuel usage, and traffic congestion, and so on. The next submodel is related to the environmental impact model. This model tracks the amount of carbon dioxide emitted from the transportation sector and includes that in the general model that calculates the atmospheric increase in the atmospheric temperature as well as the deep ocean temperature that then helps us to calculate the climate change impacts. This model helps us to simulate the atmospheric temperature change over time. It is based on the DICE model that is used in these calculations related to climate change. Next model is the precipitation and weather. And here we attempt to model or to estimate the number of days with extreme weather events up to the year 2100 based on the climate change model. So the climate change model that I show you will allow us to estimate the increase in the number of days where we have extreme weather conditions, which will impact the road safety as we talked before. Next submodel is the economic impact submodel. This model connects or considers all of the submodels I mentioned before and connects them to the economy. Each of the economic parameters discussed have some impact to the GDP, and GDP will become combined to show the overall impact at the end. After the quantifying our model and running it, the most important part is, of course, to validate our model. This is very important for the SD modeling process, and we use many tests to do that. There are two categories that we look at in these tests: model structure validity and model behavior verification. Some of which we call the first part, we call the structural validity, and the second one, behavioral accuracy of the model. Without performing these validation tests, we cannot guarantee if our model will represent the model system in reality, meaning that the model's predictions and proposed policies that are based on these predictions cannot be trustable. What we did first is we looked at the model structure validity. We looked at five different types of tests: structure verification test, parameter verification test, extreme condition test, boundary adequacy test, and dimensional consistency test. The first test ensures that the parameters in the model and the simulated relationships between them do not contradict any currently available knowledge of the system. For this, we looked at many published studies before, and made sure that our model is verified structurally. Second, we looked at the parameter verification test, both qualitatively and quantitatively. We seek to see whether our model is an adequate representation of the real system. For this purpose, all of the parameters that were in the causal loop diagram and the stock and flow diagrams are checked with the real world. Then we look at the extreme conditions test, And we do this by assigning extreme values to different parameters and see if the simulation model behaves in an expected way. The next is the boundary adequacy test, where we look whether we have included all boundary that is related to the study. And then we also look at the dimension consistency test. And next, we look at the model behavior and look at the historical data versus the simulated data. Here you see in the blue is our model, and the red is the real data since 1993 up to 2008. And we ran ANOVA test and normality test to check if the calculated or the quantified numbers show similarity with the real data, and the statistical tests show that there isn't any statistical difference between the reference mode and the model output. So all of these validation tests help us to be fairly comfortable with our model so that we can start to look at the policy analysis for the future. Again, to remind you, we use this model then to model up to year 2100. So, and we investigated three main policy areas: fuel efficiency improvements, travel demand reduction, and vehicle safety improvements. Of course, these are just some policy analysis that we wanted to test, but we can test many other policies through our model. Our model can be utilized as a test bed to analyze or to look at many different safety improvements as well. What we looked at is increasing the vehicle's overall fuel efficiency by 25% or by 50% or by 75%, and look at the result of this in our simulation. Then reducing the travel demand by 25% or by 40%, and looking at what would that do to different parameters in our model. And thirdly, to look at the improving the vehicle safety index by 10% and by 15%, and then look at the associated and respective results of these policies. So let us look at some results here. First is reducing or increasing the fuel efficiency. The reason we wanted to look at this because after releasing the climate action plan, the government has committed to a partnership with the industry to try to decrease the excessive fuel consumption and increase the fuel efficiency. Based on this plan, the fuel efficiency will be increased by 2025 by 100% and will continue to increase. So we wanted to see whether this policy will have any impact on road safety, although this policy was mostly focusing on reducing carbon dioxide emissions. The results of running this policy showed that the effect of vehicle fuel efficiency changes alone on atmospheric change were found to be not as important as other parameters. The most important reason is that the rate of the carbon dioxide emissions from the rest of the world has a much larger value compared to the carbon dioxide emissions solely from the U.S. transportation sector. So the effect of changing carbon dioxide emissions in the U.S. cannot be clearly recognized as an important game changer for the climate change as a whole. We also looked at whether the fatalities due to extreme weather changes, because with the decrease in the carbon dioxide emissions, based on this policy, the fatalities due to extreme weather changes will be decreased because there will be less impact from the transportation sector to the climate change. But as I mentioned earlier, this change is not a large change, so this continues to increase. The next policy that we looked at is the travel demand reduction. What we looked at is the how we can find certain ways to decrease, to reduce VMT while still maintaining our economic growth and the social activities at the same rate. This can be by looking at different transportation modes. We didn't look at the transportation mode, but we just changed the parameter itself by just looking at a possibility in the decrease in the travel demand. And based on that, we realized that the target demand reduction indicates that there will be some changes in the road accident fatalities for different policies. As you see, there is some change. We ran that only for certain years to see if that change will happen, and we realized that the change is happening for these particular years, and then we just let the model flow as it used to, but we can change these, as I said, model parameters accordingly for different policies. The next policy was the vehicular safety index increase. Our scenario focused only on decreasing the road accidents and the number of fatalities and injuries through increasing the safety index of the vehicles. For this purpose, two different scenarios have been tested to see their effects, whether there is a 10% increase of the safety index or whether there is a 15% decrease in the safety index. And this showed us that, yes, it will affect some decrease, but by itself it is not enough. The reason of showing these three different policies was not to suggest that one of these policies has to be utilized, but to show that this test bed now that we have can look at different policies and we can see which policies can be used together or which ones can be more effective than the other ones. And this can help us to look at the whole problem from a holistic perspective. In conclusion, reducing transportation-related emissions has negligible impacts to reduce negative effects of climate change on road safety. Reducing GHG emissions worldwide can significantly reduce the fatalities resulting from road accidents. Because when the GHG emissions worldwide, we also ran this in the model, are decreased, this will decrease the extreme weather, the probability of the occurrence of extreme weather events that are heavily related to the road accidents. Reducing the travel demand was investigated, which resulted in a significant decrease in the rate of fatalities. Improving the vehicle safety index can significantly reduce the number of fatalities. We looked only at 10% and 15%, but if we look at a 50% increase in this index, maybe with the autonomous vehicles and other things, which also can be used as different policies that can be implemented within this testbed. With this, I would like to conclude. Thank you very much for your patience, and I'll be very happy to answer any questions in the time that we have. You can type your questions in the public chat, and as I read them, I will try to respond to your questions. There's one question Don asks, looking back, are there any factors you would include or not include in your models? This is a very good question. In fact, part of the modeling there's an art component of it. Many times we struggle whether we want to include more details or less details. For this particular project, I would say that we were very happy with the level of details that we had because of the time and the budget that we had. We wanted to come up with a model that helps us to connect climate change to road safety, and we are very happy that we were able to do that. Of course, if we have a bigger budget, we would like to look at, for instance, more details, how it will affect the driver's behaviors, how it will affect the infrastructure, how climate change affects each of these ones from a more detailed perspective. So we are now, if you will, if you think of a Google map, looking at the whole world from far away. And it's giving us results that we can certainly depend on for this kind of a look. But we can also look more in detail in a certain area if there is, as I mentioned, time and budget that allow us to do that. I just received another question, follow-up question. Based on this work, what would you like to do next? This is a great question. I would be very interested to see how autonomous vehicles will affect the road safety and the climate change together. See, normally when we look at autonomous vehicles, many researchers look at the safety component of it. Many researchers look at the climate change component of it because most of these autonomous vehicles are electric vehicles, and electric vehicles will decrease GHG emissions. However, the advantage of this particular model that you are seeing here will allow us to look at both of these at the same time, because both of these are not independent from each other. As I've been mentioning, they are in the interdependence. So this would be a very interesting area that we would love to work in, to work on in the future. Any other questions? You're very welcome, Don. You can type your questions in the public chat area. Okay, I guess we don't have any other questions. I would like to thank you all for being with us today in this webinar, and I hope to be working with you to answer any of your questions. If you have any questions, here is my email address. It's my last name, tatari@ucf.edu. I would be happy to answer any of your questions via email as well, or by phone. You can also call me to talk to me. Thank you very much, and have a great day.